You can text Liz at 9 o'clock at night, she will answer you. You can text Liz at 3 o'clock in the morning, she will answer you. I've talked to her every morning this week at 3 o'clock. It's fantastic. So, I know she will be in here in just a second. I'm pretty excited about this one. I have my general managers in here. They are going to learn from it just like you guys. We do expect them to learn, and Liz is a wealth of knowledge. So if you guys see her, as many of you guys have already known, she will stop and answer any question, and she will give you her heart and soul. So don't feel like she's a stranger. Make sure you guys ask her questions. She is here for your guys' benefit. She knows a lot about this business. She does a lot for us. So without further ado, Liz Naber.
Counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again. Because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who strives to do the deeds, knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. Our place is the Sports Franchise Coliseum, the arena. The time is 2nd century AD. What am I? Does my uniform give away who I am? So I am a gladiator, and I'm an employee of Rome. The Colosseum arena was used for generations by Roman emperors. They were fierce fighters that brutalized each other for ancient Rome's sole entertainment. Gladiators were usually pitched against each other in an arena and had to sometimes fight to the death. It is believed that this brutal and infamous form of entertainment was not only restricted to men, but for a brief period of time, included women. The life of a gladiator was typically short. Most of the time, they fought among groups or within groups. Some of these fights went on until there was just one fighter standing in the arena. Gladiators fought other gladiators, wild animals, and even prisoners with no hope of freedom or survival. It was very common for the Romans to compel prisoners of war to engage in fights in the arena. The number of spectators or fans that graced the event varied from city to city. One thing is for sure, however, a large fraction of the public found the games of the gladiators very entertaining. At first, they were uncomfortable watching the murder of fellow humans, but as time went on, it became the sport of their time with fanaticism, just like our sports today. The Romans spared no expense for their very stable pipeline of slaves and convicted criminals whose sole purpose was to fight as gladiators. Regardless, gladiators were revered and in some cases idolized or worshiped for their daring acts and fights in the arena. Considering the fact that the majority of these fighters were slaves or former slaves, the organizers did not have to always get the consent of the fighters. The fans rationalized this as the criminals were getting what they deserved, and the authorities justified it as a way to control the population, that these were just the consequences of any crime. Imagine the magnitude of staff that it took to provide this entertainment for the people. Hunters travel all over the world to bring back elephants, giraffes, tigers, lynx, crocodiles, bears, and rhinoceros. To feed and house these animals in itself is staggering. Other employees were needed to purchase, imprison, feed, and train the slaves, turned gladiator, as they awaited their fate. The gladiator you would be most familiar with is the movie Gladiator, starring Russell Crowe. It's partially based on a true story, primarily factual, but with a little bit of guesswork mixed in. It goes into unsettling detail about the cruelty showcased at the Gladiator Games and other cruel forms of entertainment that exploited humans and animals in the years that saw the rapid expansion of the Roman Empire. Roman Emperor Marcus Aurelius named Maximus his faithful general, his successor. Maximus was a farmer, a family man, a Roman general who was unjustly subjected to a life of slavery by a power-hungry emperor, Commodus, who jealously stole the throne. Commodus privately heard Marcus Aurelius tell Maximus he wanted him to be the emperor when he died. Commodus was his son, so Commodus killed his own dad, pronounced himself the emperor, and then he had Maximus' family killed and sold him into slavery. Even though he died fighting in the arena, Marcus saved the mistreated Commodus family and the citizens. He inspired his men to fight for what was right, and he defended his country against evil. So what were the challenges of their time? At the whim of someone in power, their life could instantly change. It could be their death. How did Gladiator, General Maximus, farmer, slave, gladiator, how did he lead? We find that his character was always the same no matter where he was. A husband, a daddy, a farmer, a general, a slave, and finally a gladiator, where he was forced to fight until he died. He was ever a defender, protector, and never a compromiser. It was a time unlike ours, where humans and animals were mercilessly killed and wasted. So how does that apply to us? We as employees have a choice to lead from where we are. If we were just hired or a long-tenured employee, we can still lead and inspire all the way up to the owner in how we conduct ourselves, the attitude we bring to work, and the words that come out of our mouth. You can go for years holding steady, learning skills, absorbing massive, good, life-transforming content. You show up on time, you help and support wherever you can. You can watch the owner like a hawk, and because you're a person of high character, you help him in any way you can without being told. You don't expect anything in return, you just show up and give. Then an opportunity arises where someone is needed for a position that would be a promotion from where you are. You want to live and work at such an incredible level that when the employees are all looked over, that there's not even a second thought on who they should put in that position. It should be obvious it's you. A gladiator in your arena, leading from where you are in the landscape industry. Moving forward in time, we go to Germany, 1942, World War II, to observe the Reserve Police Battalion 101. This was a group of 500 ordinary men between the approximate ages of 37 and 42. Clerks, bakers, pharmacists, average citizens chosen to support the effort in the final extermination of all Jews. These men were unfit for military duty and couldn't be used as soldiers on the front lines, but they needed more manpower to carry out this plan. So they found a job for them to do. Their job was to massacre all Jews by any means necessary, even face-to-face killings. They were ordered to round up Jews and transport them to the forest and kill them. They went from city to city. They loaded Jews in trucks and trains and drove them to the forest. In other cities, they were ordered to enter and just kill every Jew they found. Any effort to fight back meant torture, torture to loved ones, cruel punishment, and death. No special favors were given. They were used to cook, work, and dig their own graves, and then killed, and others took their place. As the war went on, they started to run out of ammo. The death camp showers built in Sobibor, Treblinka, and Auschwitz were under construction and hadn't yet been completed. This is where vast numbers of Jews would be gassed and killed. These were city guys. They were not trained soldiers. They would line up the Jews kneeling in the forest, and they were supposed to go down the line and shoot them. Because they didn't have any experience, they would shoot wrong. And blood, guts, bones, and brains would spray all over them, their clothes and their faces. The soldiers had to teach them how to put a bayonet on their rifles and then hold the bayonets to their necks so they could ensure a clean kill with better aim to save on ammo. Although it sickened them, they forced the Jews to dig huge trenches and stand at the edge and shot them. They would kill the next ones the same way, layer upon layer of bodies. Many were injured, not killed, and then the soldiers would come on them as they heard them, the movement, the crying, the moaning. When they heard that, they just kept shooting until there was silence. This was a difficult assignment. The screaming, the stench of death, resistance, and momentous weight of the mission was wearing. The military brought in alcohol for the men who were out in the forest for hours, carrying out these gruesome acts to numb their senses. Keeping them drunk would ensure the work continued. These men were daddies, husbands, ordered to carry out murders of babies all the way up to the elderly. They were not mean, evil, cold-blooded killers. In testimonies from these men, they said they made it twisted excuses to make it okay by saying, well, if I killed the baby, it's okay, because if the mom was dead, the baby didn't have a chance anyway. Major Trapp, who was in charge, was reported to have said when he stood with the men and gave these orders, he gave them the option of not following through with what had to be done because it would not be easy. A couple would step out of line, knowing that with every fiber of their being, they could not follow through, they couldn't kill another human being. Of over the 83,000 Jews that were subsequently killed by these men, a very small percentage asked to ever be excused from the mission. Did it bother them? Yes. Did they want to do it? No. Then why would they? Why, knowing they had their own family, sweethearts, and children at home, could they become brute savages and kill fellow humans just like themselves? You say, I would never do that. They'd have to kill me before I would do that. Absolutely nothing could force me. For several years now, I have pondered this. There's a very heavy read called Ordinary Men, considered one of the most comprehensive writings from the Holocaust research that covers this topic. It's unfathomable and inconceivable that ordinary people like you and me could commit monstrous deeds to their fellow men. Ordinary Men gives testimony from some of these men themselves in the Reserve Battalion 101. Here's what they said. It was the idea of not pulling your weight, not supporting your comrades, not fulfilling your duty, the desire to not stand out in the crowd. You would be derided by others as weak or cowardly. Some had anxiety about job promotion, some lack of moral reflection, or others could be viewed as a shirker of the dirty work. Unspeakable acts of extreme violence executed by ordinary men. This is the incredible power of peer pressure. What were the challenges in their arena? Peer pressure to comply. Was their character the same no matter where they were? No. How could they have led from where they were? They could have said no. What value do you think they brought to the world? They didn't. How does that apply to you and me? How often do we try to hide in the crowd and refuse to stand for anything? If you stand for nothing, you'll fall for anything. We say we'd never do what those men did. Yet how often do we stop evil, stand for right, speak out, and don't? It's a serious thing to ponder, to not pass the buck, but to look inward and see if you have the propensity to take the moral high ground. Bringing it to 2023, to you and me, employees and GMs, let's flip the script to our time. Never before have employees demanded so much. They have all the rights and privileges. Owners who work hard to build businesses with employees now have those same employees calling the shots. Owners have to pay out funds they can't afford for employee benefits and get the employee to stay. The owner's motivation to grow and give is constantly being derailed by those they are providing jobs for. Owners have provided opportunities for them, continuing education, coaching, extracurricular life skills, as well as character building support, and employees are still ungrateful or leave. It makes the owner want to go back to being a solo operator when all they hear is complaining, bickering, and vying for position within their organization. Employers are afraid to make moves that would be the best for the team because they may be perceived as too harsh. So what are the challenges of our time? We have pressure of soft living. We don't have the immediate danger of death or the immediate threat of danger or death. We do, however, have symptoms of soft living. You can speak out answers if you want while I put them on the board, but I have a few I wanted to mention, and then if you think of some others. So some symptoms of our soft living, what I thought of was depression, anxiety. If you think of one before me, you can yell. Panic attacks. How about feelings of hopelessness? You can't all see this, sorry. Feelings of hopelessness. Got to spell right. How about feelings of worthlessness? I'm sure you're all relating in some degree, worthlessness. And how about, this is a big one, loneliness. There's a lot of lonely people. And then I have suicidal ideation. That is also something we see a lot, and I'm spelling wrong. And one more would be addiction. Did anybody think of any others? It would be a symptom of our soft living. So these are commonly diagnosed issues of our time. And you'll be familiar with these because we know people who suffer with them or we suffer with them ourselves. So ADHD, when you bounce around like Tigger and you can't focus on anything and you can't finish anything, that could be undiagnosed. Untreated ADHD. This will all come together and make sense for you. Bipolar, when you're on a low and you can hardly function and everything feels like you're actually crawling with weights on your back. When you're high or in a manic state, you feel awesome, focused, on the move, but you're a little paranoid and you have a little mistrust of everyone. And you might be thinking of yourself or others. So just think about that as we go through. In that state, you may spend money like crazy and destroy all your relationships, but you still feel invincible. Cyclical depression. This might be something you're not all familiar with. It's a little bit difficult to diagnose, and it can be really confusing for you and for your loved ones. So when you have cyclical depression and you're really low, you feel like you can barely move, you can barely function, or even get out of bed. Then you swing up to normal, not high, but normal, happy, almost giddy. It can be so confusing to diagnose because it's cyclical. It goes in cycles. Then there's PTSD. Conditions above that I just mentioned can trigger first episodes after a traumatizing life event. And you've probably seen this in loved ones or experienced yourself. A breakup, death, abuse, mistakes you made when you were maybe in a gang, mistakes with family, or worse, if you've been in the military, maybe crimes. Alcoholism. This is a diagnosable illness. You can be a happy drunk or a mad drunk, but as time goes on, there's sometimes irreparable damages to homes because of massive consumption. Injury. You got hurt on the job, you have experienced a lot of pain, now you have therapy, wage loss, and this can trigger guilt, anger, a lot of lows, and new feelings you've never experienced before. So there's fake solutions. There's meth, energy drinks, gambling, marijuana and nicotine, more alcohol, pain med prescriptions, which you are prescribed at the time of your injury. To deal with circumstances, weird feelings you don't understand, and memories, you numb your pain to keep you from having to face what you are, things you've gotten yourself into, as not to have to take ownership over anything in your life. I could give you illustrations of members of my team who did not take extreme ownership over themselves and their lives. For some, it brought car accidents with loss of their license. Another, a death of his girlfriend who hung herself after she had begged him to change and he would not get help. Others did take ownership. They physically moved, changed their lifestyle, where they worked, and the people they hung out with. So there are real solutions. You think that none of this matters, but think of the things I've mentioned, either things that you've taken or you're addicted to, or conditions that are diagnosable that you've seen others or yourself maybe have that definitely have affected your job. So there are real solutions. I promise you there is help. There's always Dr. Google for natural solutions on all these things. Online you can read about others who have gone through these things and you can get help. You'll get frustrated by all this info. Going to a doctor after you've educated and he can explain some of your symptoms with intelligence. Once you get on prescribed medications, you will feel great and want to go off meds. Don't. It takes 3 months, about 90 days, for your brain chemistry to change. Things will start to balance out and you'll start to feel better and better. Getting well is not overnight. You did not get sick or build bad habits overnight. You won't get well and become an eminent human overnight. But please, from the depths of my heart, as someone who would not be standing here today if I hadn't taken ownership over my life, please do the same. I have asked for this breakout session to be able to share this with you and wanted so badly to have something to share with employees, people like me. I so desperately want you to realize your value and how important you are. To understand and believe that you are the man in the arena. I'd like to show the progression of an employee to a GM and to an owner. So you have your goals and things you want to do, but you're not really sure how to get there. So I'll show you how. So think of every single thing that an owner has to deal with. And if you're a business owner and I forget any, let me know. They have to deal with a lot of stuff. And I'm going to share about 25 of them. So this is you down here. And this is the owner. And I tried to think of everything they have to deal with. So I started simply. So mowers, hand tools, trucks, trailers. These are just the simple everyday things. Fuel. Anybody want to help me with more?
Maintenance.
What'd you say?
Maintenance.
Yep, maintenance. Maintenance and repairs. And then I have, guess what? They have to deal with you. They have employees. They also have their family. They have to get insurance. They have to deal with money. Wouldn't that be a nice problem? Customers, fun topic.
Grass.
What'd you say?
Grass.
Novel thought in our industry.
Weather.
They have to deal with call outs.
Complaints.
They have to, well, complaints from us or from customers?
Customers.
Okay, that'll be with customers. So education, they have to keep educating themselves. They have to buy uniforms. I got fuel over here.
Time.
Girlfriend. Software. Sorry, what'd you say?
Girlfriends.
Man. They have to deal with them, poor guys. Injured employees.
Benefits.
Okay. Injured, sorry, employees. Benefits. Look at all the stuff they got to deal with. You sure you want to be a GM or a business owner?
Quality, yeah.
Quality, you said?
Yeah. Marketing.
Marketing. Somebody said something over here?
P&L.
Payroll.
Payroll.
Image.
Selling. So I'll put estimates in that. That'll be part of selling.
Brand image.
Hiring. You guys thought of more than me. Brand image.
Yeah, legal and licensing.
Fun. Licensing. L-I-S. L-I-C. Licensing. My circle. Oh, yep. They have to deal with their shop, their property.
Health.
Going to conferences across the country.
Their own health. That would be education.
Billing.
What do you say? Billing. Yes. Invoicing.
Motivator.
They have to be the motivator. Did I get expenses? No. I'll use that one. Motivator. You mean they have to be their therapist? Nice. They have to be the therapist.
How about leader?
They have to be a leader. Okay, so let's let the man have a breath, woman, whoever they
circle.
I need a bigger circle. So, have you ever thought of all the stuff they have to deal with? Well, now you get hired, and this is how you move your way up to be an owner. So you're just hired, you don't know anything. And he teaches you how to run a mower. And your goal inside that you never share with anyone is that you want to be really good at your job, you want to be noticed, and you someday want to own your own business, but you don't tell him that. So this is you out here, and this is you once you've started, before you started, and now you started, and you start taking care of the mowers. And you see that the hand tools are in disarray and they're not organized. So watch how the two of these go in and tie together. You've taken over two things for him. They're like stackable skills that you've learned. Then you see the guys are not cleaning the trucks like they should. They're not getting all the trash out at the end of the day. And you would say, oh, just, they can, I spelled that wrong. Somebody misled me. And then you start to clean out the trucks. You're not getting paid for this because it's not really on, you're getting paid for performance. So you didn't ask to do that for somebody else. But the trailers have to be plugged in every night, and you go and check and make sure they are. You make sure that all the guys have fuel for the trucks, and they all keep stacking on top of each other, and you keep taking more and more that he is teaching you off his plate. You don't ever say anything more. This is without words. You just keep doing everything you can to support him. Then you take care of the maintenance. You're not really here where you can take care of employees or any of these things, but you can be a leader. And you could support the employees, but not yet. But you can take care of the shop. And then what else could you take care of really at this point of being? You can take care of the grass and not the weather yet. We'll get to that one. Anything else you could take care of just as an employee without a lot more training?
Right, you're the customers.
What's the customer
doing? You can take care of the customers, that's right. And brand image, but you don't really know much about that or even understand it. However, you started listening to Audible and you started to listen to podcasts that were about our industry. You YouTubed everything you've done so far, how to take care of these. You created a system, a tagging system for maintenance, for repairs. And you just talked to the other guys about a better way to do it to make sure they all had their stuff when they left for the day. And you did that without ever having to say anything. So then you talk to the owner and you say, I'm really wanting to learn a little bit more. Can you teach me some things? So he decides that he's going to teach you about estimates. And he takes you out on a Saturday and does estimates with you because he needs you to work during the week. And this is going to cost him extra money if he just takes off with you throughout the day when there's other jobs to do. So you start selling, you're able to do some estimates. Another thing you can take care of right now is the property. There's always mowing and edging. If your property looks good and it's somewhere that's customer facing, then that is really important. So can you imagine you, if there's business owners or even you as an employee, can you imagine having a coworker who is like this? Or if you were the owner, you'd be blown away, right? This person is just taking care of this stuff. Like, I'm kind of puzzled by this. So all this time, when you're working, you have one earbud in all day. You want to keep one out so you can talk to the customers and your coworkers. But you've been watching and listening to all these podcasts. Don't watch while you drive like me. It's not healthy. But then you ask him if you can learn a little more. So he brings you into the office. Oh, another thing we had forgot was the CRM. We'll add that. So he teaches you about the CRM, which is where it's now connected to the selling. He shows you how to work the software, and all this time he's been giving you good counsel about life, about your girlfriend, and you start to realize that if you're going to be this eminent human being, take all this stuff on and become an owner, it starts to conflict with the girlfriend, doesn't it? They don't always get it, and if you're really pressing this hard, taking all the overtime you can, she's not always going to be supportive. And I know some guys, they've really set their goals on owning the business and they want the girlfriend, but sometimes you can't have it all at the same time. So they end up just saying, for now, we're on good terms, but we just need to part ways. I don't know if we'll be together later, but I need to reach these goals for now. So as you're in the office, you're able to take care of more and more for him. You start listening to the other guys and kind of pointing them in the right direction. You tell them, you know, I read such and such a book last week, and this might really help you in your relationships. You also can start helping with the employees. Guess what this just did? This gave the owner time to be with his family. But there's so much more you want to understand. So you start talking to him about marketing. That is something you can learn about. But it didn't even matter before. The brand image never even mattered before, because you didn't understand it. Now you start to get it as you listen to all these Audible books. Every time you listen to one, they talk about another one, and it just snowballs until you're hearing one after another. You never run out of stuff to listen to and learn. So you tell him, I would like to learn more, so I'm gonna ask you if you'll teach me about invoicing. Can I have a look at the expenses? And then he sees, oh my word, this is how much we spend on fuel. This is how much we spend on insurance and licensing. So he's like, let me learn about that and let me start handling some of that for you. So the owner hands him a credit card because now he trusts him. He's never seen this employee do anything that he couldn't have confidence in him. So now this employee is in the office, you see. So now he can help with the expenses, the licensing, not here yet, but he can help with the weather because now he can route and optimize the routes and send the guys out. If they have a lot of rain, he now knows how to select them on the dispatch board and move them to another day. He also knows how to select all of them and one click and email them all that we can't come today, but we'll be back tomorrow. He then handles the call outs because now he can do the rerouting. He can buy the uniforms. And guess what he just did? He bought the owner a whole bunch of time. So quality control, he has to start working with the team, so he's really having to lead a lot now, which can be very challenging. As you see, bit by bit, nobody's going to just give all this to an employee until they've started to have some sort of conversation. Because now they're in the money. They got their, they know how much they're making, their boss is making. If you're really immature, you're going to start thinking the owner's making all this money, I'm not getting a piece of it, whatever. But now they understand P for P. They're learning this as they go, so now he trusts them with money. Then he starts to learn the benefits of insurance, all that it costs the owner. He learns about it himself. He's able to pay the insurance bill, talk to the insurance agent. He can deal with injured employees. He can deal with the L&I claims, because all of these come in the mail. He opens the mail. If he has issues, he can talk to the owner about it. There are benefits besides just the insurance, and maybe he has a conversation with the owner and says, it's like we've implemented recently, if you don't need insurance, a lot of the younger guys are on their parents' insurance, can we do a gym credit? So we call it a wellness credit where they can go to massage, acupuncture, whatever, or the gym, and then every quarter they can submit their receipts and we pay them back. So that's a lot of benefit. Quality control, let me tell you, now they're on P for P and he cares. Now the owner has made him the GM, and he tells him he's going to give him 25% if he runs all of this without the owner having to be involved every day. That's a huge piece of the pie. So let me tell you, he's making sure that all there's very little callbacks, and they're all on P for P. So now he can handle the P&L. He can start doing the payroll. Because he's a person of integrity, he doesn't talk about it. He doesn't talk about what everybody makes per hour. This does not happen overnight. This comes from them watching you. Their business is their baby. And to hand it over to somebody else is a huge deal. So now he'll let you hire. And now he can focus on his health. And he can step almost out of the business. You already started your education. You keep doing that. You're working on quality control. And the taxes, that's a big one. So you're going to have to really educate yourself on this. A lot of audibles, you can learn a ton. And then you can give him some pointers on how to save on taxes. So all of this stuff, one by one, stackable skills on top of each other, made you the GM. And now you think, I know how to do everything he does. So maybe I could own my own business pretty soon. So you start researching how you could do that. You get a plan in place. And then you don't just pull this on him. So you go to the owner and you say, I've learned everything from you and I so appreciate it and I want to leave on really good terms, but I think I'd like to start my own location. So maybe in like 3 months, and I've been watching so-and-so and they've really stepped up recently. They've been listening to a lot of good content and I've just watched them change. And if it's okay with you, I'd love to start training them on some of these things and let them just take ownership for it and train other people. Would you be in favor of that? And the owner's like, yeah, sure, I really trust you. And he made a deal with him that he wouldn't take any of the current customers unless there was a complaint and the owner lost the customer themselves. You guys, this is possible to have these kind of conversations and work in the same area. Maybe one person just wants to do lawn care. Maybe this guy is just going to go do projects, which means they can still work in the same area and they can not share clients, but they can refer each other as separate companies to take care of all these customers. So this is little bitty you, and now the owner steps out of the business and he's now working with you on the business, and then you step out and you become the owner of your own company. And the awesome part is you've been an employee all this time. You know exactly how they feel. You know the mistrust, you know all the things, like the frustrations in the day that you get so mad at the owner. And now you felt all that because you, lucky you, you got to take ownership of all this stuff without having to pay for anything. And you got paid while you learned all this stuff. And so I encourage you to just tuck it away inside yourself. You don't have to flaunt it. But it's just high quality people that learn and grow until they can make their dreams come true. So I am an employee. I was the office manager for Augusta Bellingham and ran their field crews. I'm now a business owner myself. I own a property management company, and I'm now a COO of Augusta, and it's a growing landscape franchise company, as you know. But I'm still an employee, so I've covered the broad spectrum, felt all the feelings, and experienced all the growing pains like you. My most challenging obstacle in all these years of employment has been me. Whether it's influence from those I'm surrounded with, my family, religion, complexes, disagreements with my boss, illness, whatever, I realize that I've always been the problem. Hindsight, as we know, is 20/20, and we can all armchair quarterbacks and judge others, but this is a safe place to really look inward and tie this all together. So ask yourself, is your character the same no matter where you are? How do you lead from where you are? Do you like the place you're leading from? Do you have ambition to grow your own company or own your own business someday? Lawn care and landscaping is where you are now, maybe, but that's not the end goal. Maybe there's never been a wasted skill that you've learned along the way, and I'm a testament to that. Things I thought I was wasting my time learning, even on my own time, have all in amazing ways panned out, and I'll say even I was in the medical field and worked with a lot of dementia patients, and let me tell you, that works with customers. That training has really come in handy. So in all the schooling and all the jobs you have, none of that will ever be wasted. There's no positive personal growth that you will ever regret. Everything prepares you for something. Your goals might seem huge and so far away, but I've shown you how it happens and how you get there. You can lead from all these stages. So it takes no effort to be a loser. It takes massive action to change. Growth is so painful. Don't wait to be pushed out of your comfort zone. Just step out into it voluntarily. How can you bring value to the world? Lead from where you are. Lead yourself. Doing this will make you self-prepare to set your own standard. You don't have to wait for your position to change. Just change to be ready for the challenge that you don't even know is coming your way. So you say, Liz, where do I start? Work out, eat clean, discipline yourself, and structure your day. Get help for any of the conditions that I talked about. Potent, silent, exemplary leadership. Leading yourself. Not looking around to think, oh, I've got to pass this exam, I need this required certification, but just dominate yourself, encouraging yourself, take care of you, your brain, the atmosphere and the energy that you create around yourself. You don't need to use words or brag or explain to others what you're doing. You don't need to pretend humility. You'll be so focused on progress and transformation in yourself that you just move. You won't wonder if you're watched. Believe me, you will be. Kind words, harsh words, they don't matter. You just move. Emotions never get a vote. They're not the champion running the show. Just move. Do you feel anxious, depressed? Smoke or drink to numb your pain? I know this seems like it doesn't matter in our industry, but do you need drugs to help you? You know deep inside, you may lose people you love because you're ill or you're bipolar, ADHD, something that it's affecting the job, but you won't make the effort to change or to get better. Maybe you have a loved one who keeps asking you to wear your safety gear because they care, and you're just slothful and ignore it. Turn off chatter and mindless entertainment. Turn on podcasts, YouTube stuff, and lawn care, landscape, leadership, business. Get your own Audible account, which will be like a mobile university. Everything I'm saying is from experience, and I really feel like I have a degree in psychology for sure, and business and everything, just because of the, without exaggeration, thousands of books that I've listened to. So I would listen with one earbud in and I would listen every hour I was alone while I was awake, whatever you do. I just wouldn't turn it off. A lot of times when you're plagued by some of these things, you're in a really dark place in your head, and you can't even think something positive. Or if you're in a victim mentality from stuff you've been through, from having PTSD, if you just put it in your ears and just listen, it won't give you a choice but to get pulled out of it. There's a lot of even websites that are, or podcasts that are Motivation University or any of those, and it's basically somebody just yelling motivation in your ear. Somebody took the time to make all those. They're very helpful. And no, you're not going to want to hear this all the time. I've heard a lot of guys say, I don't get half of it. No, it's all in the weeds. I don't understand. This one guy told me, I've tried to listen to Extreme Ownership tons of times. It makes no sense. I don't know anything about that military stuff. And I said, neither do I. But I understand about owning my own stuff and extreme ownership. So listen anyway. This is an example that one of my employees said. He said, you know, I don't understand hardly any of it, but I just keep playing it and playing it. And he said, and then one day Mike said, oh, the ROI on that. And he's like, I was like, return on investment. That's what it means. And he said, it was so awesome to know that I had just got that while I was working, listening to all this stuff I never thought I would understand. So in conclusion, I gave you all a card. Some of you got it. Did you get that? I want you to know that you are loved and valued. And leaving today, you have made the decision. I'm hoping that you've made and will make the decision to become a warrior and a savage and make a difference where you are for the good. And I'm going to read this one more time, and I'd like you to read it with me as we close. And if you could keep that at home somewhere, and I think it'll help you in the future. It's not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who strives to do the deeds, knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. You are that man. Lead, O man in the arena, from where you are. The end. If you want to ask me questions, you can. I don't know everything, but what I know, I'm open to. Sure, go for it.
I'd like a list of your top 10 audibles.
Oh, I can get you those. Okay, well, Extreme Ownership is going to be the first one. And then Strategies and Tactics. What's the whole title? You know?
Highly Effective Leader.
Yeah, Highly Effective Leader is good. I'm not even going to be able to name all of them. Mike, do you want to help me?
There's a post on the Lock Your Millionaire.
Yes, I have lots posted that people have asked for. I'd be happy to share that. I can get that for you.
I can look it up here.
Okay, yeah, it's on there. Anybody else? Marcus, do you know some of my other favorites?
Ultimate Sales Machine, you like that one?
Yes.
Linchpin!
So Good They Can't Ignore You, Linchpin. Does everybody know what a linchpin is? I know you're thinking trailers, right? A linchpin is a person in a business that the business cannot function without. And that's what you want to try to be. I tried to be that for Mike, and I thought, how in the world am I going to be the kind of employee that no business could do without? Because you say it's impossible. Everybody's irreplaceable. But what I started to do was just study him. watch how he did everything, and I'm like, I can do that. I can take that off his plate. You're like, I got this, you know, you go ahead. It takes a long time for them to trust you enough to take the thing, but that worked well for me. Linchpin, that's a great book. You gotta read that one. All Jocko's books, read those lots. Anybody else? Y'all know everything already. Dylan, did you have a question?
No, I didn't have a question.
April, did you have a question?
What do you do if you disagree with like the owner on like a process or procedure for something?
Yes, that is a challenge. First of all, when you're right in the middle of a mission or right in the middle of the day and you're on a job, don't say anything then. Like, just roll with it.
Right.
So, for instance, we had one time where we have the route for the day and the guys are all rolling back and we need to shift things around. Like, somebody needs to go pick up a truck or we need to deliver this product. And Mike walked in. I was working with the guys and he walked in and he's like, oh, you do that and you do that. And I was like, I had a plan.
Right.
And I don't know if he told me at that time that his plan was better or whatever, but he backed off. He backed off. The guys ended up doing what I said. And it's like, I think it was that you said yesterday was, or this morning, that to listen, because sometimes the owner will be right. But it's all in your approach. If you come back, there's lots of times I was right, or that's the whole idea that you're there, is because you have something he doesn't have. And that's what makes you so awesome together. So it is really important for you to say. Mike would get really mad when I wouldn't say. And he'd say, like, you're being quiet, like, what's up? And I'm like, well, I don't think that we should handle that like that, or I definitely think we should do that. Be mature enough to actually give your opinion.
Right.
So right in the middle of the day when it's happening, though, just roll with it, whatever they say. You know, in the military, they do a recon when it's over. But right in the middle of it, somebody's got to call the shots, and everybody's got to go for it. So does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyone else?
What advice would you give to GMs or employees that want to be a GM and they're competing against other people to make sure
in the company?
Yeah.
Yeah. This is the thing. The owner's already watching, and like I just said, it should be, and you can tell the guys this, that they are working so hard on themselves and ignoring all the competition and trying so hard to be an eminent human being. Why don't they pretend they're the owner and start acting like the owner in everything they do? And then the owner is not even gonna acknowledge he's seeing all that. The owner sees people vying for position and trying to be teacher's pet and all this stuff. But Mike has actually had that conversation with our team. So we had Marcus moving out because he's gonna own his own business. And everybody knows that position is coming forward. And Mike said, I'm not just gonna go, oh, you've been here the longest, you're gonna get that position. He said, I'm gonna watch the person that is ready. So when we hired Marcus, he didn't know much about lawn care or landscaping, and within 6 months, we had him doing estimates. And that's very confusing to other employees, right? You've got this young kid, he's 18, and you're letting him do all this stuff. Understandably, it frustrates everybody else. But what we saw, and this is what you can say to those employees, it's really childish to do all that competing. If you don't even look around and you're so focused on doing what you're supposed to do, the owner's gonna notice you, and that's the person he's gonna choose. He's gonna choose the person that, when he considers every other person, there's not even a second thought. It's definitely so-and-so. And if they all act that immature, when we had to make that decision about Dylan, there were other people that thought they really should have that position. They signed this little stupid petition, you know, about who they thought should be in the company. And it's just like, whatever. Like, Mike just told them plainly at a meeting without acknowledging that he had read this ridiculous letter and all of this, which they're just trying, right? They're trying to point out the strong people in the company. But the owner knows what he needs, and he knows the quality that he needs to leave behind him. And so, yeah, I would just tell him to grow up, and really, it is the next step. I mean, you people that are here and making an effort, you're the ones that the owner notices. So, yeah.
How do you deal with, like, when you're trying to, like, when you're working really hard and grinding and, like, taking all of these over for the owner and stuff like that, how do you deal with important people in your life, like, speaking into, like, how much, like, you are working and being worried mm-hmm. about you and stuff like that. Like, mm-hmm. like family, not so much, like, friends. You can mm-hmm. make friends, but, like, parents, like...
They're not going to understand because you're really weird.
Yep.
Anybody who works that hard on themselves and has a goal like that, the people who love you most can actually be the ones that try the hardest to derail.
So tired,
you need to sleep, you know, you're gonna get sick, but think about it. This is a good answer for them. So what do you want me to do? Work 8 hours, and I'm a guy, and I have lots of energy, and there's still lots of stuff I wanna do. Do you want me to go party all night? Like, ask them if they want you to do that. I've actually heard parents say to their kids, I liked you better before. Because they became such an amazing leader that even their family was intimidated by them. So you have to ignore that, because just the people around you are not the people in the whole world. You know, if you put yourself up against really high quality athletes that were training for the Olympics or something, you're gonna look like a wimp. So pretend that you're around the best of the best. And when you're in an environment like that, they're just gonna be seeing your weaknesses. Pretend that's what it's like. I try to never look at the people around me to be my standard, and so nobody's gonna understand. It'll be very few. And that's like when you come to events like this and you've never been before, you'll be like, hallelujah, somebody understands me. Somebody's kinda like me, and they wanna talk about business, and they actually wanna get somewhere. I had one young man that worked for us, and he said he just wanted a different life because everybody in his town worked in a factory, came home, sat on the porch, drank beer, watched TV, and went to bed. And that's what they did their whole life. And you know what he did? He moved to states away, and he was only 18. He gave all that up because there's no way, and even now I would say that some of them misunderstand him a little bit, but they have to admit now that they're pretty blown away and proud about how far he's come. So, yeah. How much time do we have, Mike? A couple minutes? Go ahead, Dustin.
Hey, sorry if this is repetitive because I just walked in, but I think that Mike's really good at delegation, but from your perspective, what is maybe like one or two things that he really did to set you up for success in your job?
Yeah, so what happened was we did peer reviews, and we do them anonymously, and so we hear everything the employees say about us, good or bad. So they were pretty harsh on us, and it was so harsh, like he takes it really seriously. You're trying to be this great leader, right? We spent 3 hours talking about all the things they had said, and then we made a list of everything he does, everything he does. And then we decided, what are we gonna start giving away? But before that, when I started working with him, when he gave me, let's say, the email, first the phone calls, right? If you didn't have command or somebody answering your phone, but you could give somebody the phone calls. Then let's say you give them the email, you don't ever, ever, ever go in there and write another email from yourself again, like from the company email. It's the worst thing you can do, because you're gonna go in and you're gonna answer Betty Sue's question, and they're like, yes, I get her, I get him again. I get the attention from the owner, because they're always gonna want you, right? So I would just say that once you hand something over, don't take it back. And he disagreed with how I answered some of them, and believe me, I really messed up. And so I had to call and apologize. I mean, what's the worst thing that can happen? Hey, I just did this estimate wrong. I was only $30,000 off. You know, it's embarrassing. But I've made every mistake imaginable. But I think the important thing is, once you give it away, don't take it back, no matter what it is. And the first things were probably emails, estimates, the phone. Those were the top ones. But you've already given those to command, so you think beyond that, what you should let your guys be in control of or hand off? Is that what you want to know?
Yeah, just, you know, however, did Mike just kind of like throw you into the job, or was it?
Yes, he did. I worked at the hospital, and the next day I was on a tractor. And I had never been on a tractor, and I was trying to load product up in a dump truck, and I didn't know you're supposed to have this thing on the back to weight it down, and I went, and I was just hanging on the truck. And you know they have stoning in the Bible. I can truly say I've been stoned, because the thing, all the gravel came back on me. from the thing. So that's the thing. Just throw them in. If they're people that are really trying to impress you already and have already made changes, they're going to figure it out, aren't they?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Just basically you and Mike building up the franchise from nothing, and probably most impressively Command Center. How many people are working at Command Center right now?
20-something.
Uh-huh. So what would you say with all your experience, because the way you've talked to me, you've changed it up, the structure of teams,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
in terms of communication, what's going to be most effective for team sizes. With your experience and all the books you read, what is the most effective team size?
Jocko says you can't manage more than 5 people effectively. That's a very small number. So maybe in the military, but I think you could manage 7. I kind of think more, but that is like the standard thing. 7 people is about what you can manage, and then you need to have them manage something else. But overall, I manage it all, but I've handed off stuff to other people. So divided the team up, gave them all, so like Lonnie has certain people that run certain departments, but they still come about the bigger things. There has to be somebody that makes the final call or makes the decision. You're not always going to agree with them, but somebody has to. And the same with, I'm not always going to make the right decision or put the teams together right. And if I do, I apologize and I say, I am really sorry I put you in the wrong spot. And I'm going to find another spot for you or you'll shine. So you can't have a fixed mindset, because businesses evolve and change. They're like this moving, living structure. And if you plan to scale really big, you can't keep the same system and then expect that it's going to stay the same forever. Because like I said to the franchisees the other day, when you have a business and it's small, you can be what's called a generalist, where everybody can do every single thing. But as it starts to get bigger, the areas of business become like branches on a tree, and then they have all the pieces coming off that. And it's too intricate and a waste of money to train everybody in the business how to do it. So for instance, we really push that you shouldn't have only one person that can know how to do irrigation or something like that. You simplify your services. But you wouldn't take every single person on your team if you had a team of 30 people and teach them how to do it. It would be stupid. Because we think that you should train them on everything on simple services, but you think of the cost of money to train every single person. So then you split them up, right? So a business will evolve and grow, and you have to change and grow with it.